Hey, y'all. Welcome to Georgia Living Podcast. This is Chris. I'm Celine.
Hey, y'all. You want to try that again?
What do you want me to do?
I don't know. You let me say my own name? No, that's fine. Hey, everybody. All right. Well, it is Tuesday, October 8th. Welcome to the Georgia Living Podcast. And today we're going to talk a little bit about what's happening in Georgia. We've got some great fall festivals coming up. We're going to talk about what's in style for your house. And we've got a community spotlight where we're going to be talking about Blue Ridge, Georgia today. So thanks for tuning in. If you haven't already, please like and subscribe. If you're following along on YouTube or in any of your favorite podcast players, please subscribe so you don't miss a beat about what's happening in and around Georgia. So Celine, it's good to have you back. Couldn't be on last week's episode, but welcome back to the show.
Yes.
Missed you.
Yes. So, you know, it wasn't your place to say, and I don't think you would want to, but
no.
I have spontaneous anaphylaxis.
Really?
So, every now and then I'll go into random anaphylaxis and it wears me out, obviously. So, I wasn't here last week. So, hi.
Usually takes a couple of days for you to get all your strength back.
Yeah. Don't know what causes it.
We'll figure it out.
Yeah.
So it's good to have you here. A few weeks ago on episode 2, we were talking about our time in Ellijay. We're up there for fall break. We did get our apples as promised, and Celine did make the pies. Now, you were a little reluctant to do this.
So, okay, here's how the story goes. We go into the Red Apple Barn, which is really close by our cabin, and we go there every year. Granny Smith apples are the best to make apple pie, and I wasn't going to make it. I was being lazy. I know it's his favorite food, but
it is.
I just didn't want to because it's by hand, you know. It's just, but all of a sudden there was this giant, I don't even know, like bigger than a shopping bag of Granny Smith apples at the checkout. So I was voluntold.
Like a half bushel.
Yeah. Yep. I was voluntold. So I made 4 of them.
So, well, we had discussed and I had expressed my interest in you possibly making the pies well in advance of going to the Red Apple Barn. So we go to the Red Apple Barn.
No, you've been talking about it. I've been just listening.
I have been talking about it. I've been asking and hounding and years, actually, a couple of years.
Every year.
So we go to the Red Apple Barn. We go into the back room where they've got everything pre-bagged and in their size containers. And I grab this little small half-peck bag for mom. I'm bringing some apples back for her. And Celine starts walking out of the back room like empty handed. And so I of course had to suggest that we can't not have the apple pies just for our listeners. They have to be able to see what came out. So we do have some images. We'll have those up on selectrealty.com with the post with this episode so you can see her apple pie.
Is that what you were doing? You were taking pictures?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I documented the whole process. So not only will you have pictures of Celine's amazing apple pie, which didn't last long.
You were taking boudoir photos of my apple pie.
I am not going to comment on that. We are going to post the recipe along with the photos of the pie on the selectrealty.com page. So you'll have a link in the show notes. If I can get Celine to be willing to share the recipe, maybe we'll post that along with it.
I will post a very similar recipe, but I will not post my secret ingredient. Ooh. And I need to move because this band of light is in my eyes.
Yeah, get that out of your eye.
It's been following me all morning.
The sun moves.
Yeah. Yes, it does. And we have another moon now. It's an asteroid.
We do.
Yeah.
We have a temporary moon. It is, we have an asteroid that is in orbit right now. It's with us. I think it's been with us since the end of September, and it's going to remain in orbit until early November, and
so
then
weird.
It'll come out of the gravitational orbit and resume its course, which is really weird. Yeah, it's pretty small. Apparently, you're not supposed to be able to see it with a satellite, like a not a satellite, like a home telescope. Those are going to be too small to be able to see it. No, not according to the article that I wrote or read.
Why even tell us about it then?
I don't know. I'm sure there's people out there that have telescopes that are strong enough to see that object, but it's moving pretty fast. It's relatively small. So,
well, you know, the difference in the sky at night from Metro Atlanta to North Georgia or even South Georgia is incredible. It's the difference is stark.
It is, yeah. And we've got some great weather right now. So if you get a chance to get up to North Georgia, I highly encourage it. It's the perfect time of year. It is the first day of 2024, this fall, that we are sub 60 degree start to the day. It's really nice. We're going to have hopefully some great colors with the trees coming up soon.
And they've started falling.
The leaves have started falling. Mm-hmm. Well, I don't think Helene helped much with that.
No, and we actually have cooler weather because it's coming down from Canada and it's pushing down that hurricane from coming back up to us right now.
So yes.
It's going to stay in Florida. It's going to hit like what, Orlando, Mickey Mouse. Oh no.
send them running. Hope everybody in Florida is going to be safe and takes the necessary precautions getting ready for this storm. And speaking of the storm, if you have been impacted or know somebody who has been impacted in eastern Georgia from Helene, we did see in the news today that Governor Kemp and FEMA have now, they're accepting applications for emergency relief. So contact FEMA. Make sure you get your applications in if you or somebody else that you know is in dire need or needs assistance. Please go through the proper channels. Make sure that you're signed up. Make sure that you have all of your applications in so that you can get relief sooner rather than later. And as always, our thoughts and prayers are with all of you. We've got some photos to share. My buddy Ryan was able to go up Friday. They delivered 3 trailer loads to Western North Carolina of supplies, water, generators, chainsaws, which is just fantastic to watch our communities come together like this, including some donations from us went to assist with that effort.
I heard Dolly Parton donated $1 million because a lot of her family lives there too.
That's fantastic. And Dolly's such an amazing person with her Books for Kids program and just right up there with what we would expect from her. But speaking of North Georgia and Helene, the good news is that we still have lots of fall festivals that are going to be going on because Helene did go so far east that, you know, the Ellijay Apple Festival still on. The dates for that are going to be October 12th through the 13th, and then the 19th and the 20th. So it's 2 weekends. The event will highlight family-friendly nature. The cost is $10 for adults. Kids 12 and under are free. What makes the festival a great annual tradition is just the low cost. It's perfect for apple picking, arts and crafts, and tasting delicious treats. You know, I avoided the fried pie.
And the cider donuts. However, you did have to buy the loaf of bread because our daughter smashed it.
Yeah.
And the cash register person was not happy.
The folks over at the Red Apple Barn, so nice.
Yeah, they were gracious.
Dealing with kids. Our 6-year-old decided to go over to the loaf and just kind of whack it around. So we did end up buying that one.
Yeah.
There's going to be plenty of apple picking, lots of arts and crafts.
The one thing that you have to watch out for with the Apple Festival, though, is because there aren't that many roads there. A lot of them are 1-lane roads.
Yeah.
Or, you know, two lane. I'm sorry. Yeah. Like going, you know.
One in each direction.
Yes. So because of that, and the infrastructure there, you get some traffic jams, especially, you know, think about it, the Metro Atlanta population going up there for that, they're going to crowd everything. And so a lot of the times you will be stuck in traffic. make sure you account for that because it can put a damper on your experience.
Oh, definitely. The, Appalachian Highway, which 575 becomes 515, which is Zell Miller Mountain Parkway now. Mm-hmm. And if you're coming up Saturday morning, it's going to be packed. Plan to sit in traffic. One of the best ways to experience the Apple Festival in Ellijay, come up, rent a cabin, and stay for the weekend. Get up on Friday, beat the traffic, get out early, get your great parking spots, and enjoy. Stay for a while.
There's another city that has stuff going on.
There's a few.
Yes, and your favorite is Helen.
So Oktoberfest is still going on. Yeah. On their website, they have an announcement that it is still on. That has been going on all weekend, or every weekend through September, but now it's going on daily until October 27th. So Helen's...
Do you Helen want to explain Helen? What Helen is?
I would love for you to.
All right. So this is what I remember right now. I did not look this up before I started to explain it. But Helen is a small North Georgia town that has been around for a very long time, and they needed some income into their economy. And so the city planners, I think, got into scenarios, and they decided that, hey, Georgia doesn't have a Oktoberfest German type of village. A lot of places do, but we don't. So they went in, and admittedly, some places are very cheesy and tacky. There's a lot of hand-painted, not that that's bad, but a lot of hand-painted, like, little, girls and boys in the lederhosen outfits. Yeah. And then they're on the sides of the walls of all the stores. A lot of the architecture, even the McDonald's there, is all Alpine. So you kind of get in the feeling like you're not in Georgia anymore, but you are. And to go along with the cheesiness, you can go bar hopping as well, which I do not participate in. I don't care for alcohol, but he does. He's Irish.
So Oktoberfest is just a great... great event. For years, Ryan, who is at Country Financial, and another friend of ours, we would go up there and do guys weekend, just get away, because you can either rent a chalet or rent a cabin. You can rent a condo and be walkable to downtown Helen, or you can go off into some of the national forest and parkland that surrounds Helen and camp. And we've done both. Mm-hmm. It's a great celebration of German culture and heritage, of which I am not, but I get you are.
Yeah.
I definitely have rocked the I have an Oktoberfest hat at the house with lots of pins from different years. It's great to collect.
Yeah.
The Fest Hall is the center of the action in downtown Helen. If you go to the Oktoberfest website, we'll post the link in the show notes. You can see the address, where it is, what the hours are. But basically, you go there, they've got great polka music, and lots of dancing.
Dance?
I am not a big polka dancer. I'm not
poker.
Even a
polka.
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 The Massachusetts accent comes out sometimes. But it is it's wonderful. And I've done the chicken dance. I've done the chicken dance with...
The chicken dance?
Oh, yeah. Like it's great. You go, and the Fest Hall is just a bunch of tables. You get...
this one?
Pretzels and beer cheese and giant beers, and it's just a really great event, because you'll be sitting at the table with your group, and right across the table from you, we've met people from Sweden and all over the world,
and they come to Helen,
and they'll come to Helen. Yeah, it's just a great
when
experience.
They have Germany right by them, the real deal, they come to Helen.
So you experience the Fest Hall at night. There's lots of bars and restaurants that sell German food. There's fudge shops and all sorts of little
it is a tourist price
stores
town,
to explore. Yeah, great restaurants.
Beer boots?
Das Boot. Yep.
Das Boot,
you,
yeah.
You can get plenty of Das Boots. You'll see people walking around with them.
I'm sure those are $30 nowadays, right?
Probably. Yeah. Maybe more.
40?
Well, you're paying for the souvenir cup, too.
Oh, you get to keep it.
Oh, they actually sell the glass big Das Boot cups.
Is that why we had one in our house?
We did have one for a while. The boot is gone, but we still have the beer steins. And so make sure that you get up there. Check out Oktoberfest happening in Helen, Georgia now through October 27th. The earlier you go, the better the pin selection is. So if you're interested in collecting pins and collecting them on a hat, get out there early in the month. Not too far away from Oktoberfest, Dahlonega this month is having its Gold Rush Days Festival. And this is going to take place October 19th and 20th to celebrate Dahlonega's 1828 gold discovery and the beautiful fall colors that bring thousands to this event.
Yeah. I mean, think about it. San Francisco 49ers, right? 1849.
Mm-hmm.
What year was this?
1828.
Yeah. There you go.
Yeah. So
21
years before the 49ers.
The California Gold Rush.
If you're
it was Georgia.
Yeah. And if you're new to the state or the community, Dahlonega is a very important part of Georgia's history because the gold that was mined in Dahlonega is actually what coats the dome of the Capitol building in downtown Atlanta.
Do you remember hearing the story from Governor Deal?
Yes, I do.
Oh,
but I'll let you share that one.
Oh, well, we got to listen to his story about how when he was younger, they were replacing the dome for the iconic Capitol Dome for Georgia in downtown Atlanta. And there was like a reenactment of how they brought the gold to the Capitol and they redid it. And he came on horseback all the way to Atlanta to deliver the gold from Dahlonega.
That's right.
I think that's so cool.
Yeah, that's really cool. The Gold Rush Days Festival is going to highlight over 200 art and craft exhibitors. There'll be food vendors and the excitement of this top Southeast tourism event. So that again, October 19th and 20th. We will have links to all of these festivals in the show notes and available on selectrealty.com.
So in relation, Ellijay is about an hour and a half from downtown Atlanta.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe two, depending on traffic. Dahlonega is how far?
Dahlonega is going to be about a similar distance, but instead of going up 575, you're going up 400.
Right. And then Helen is a little bit more towards the North Carolina, South Carolina side.
More central.
Yeah.
Closer to the Tennessee border. So you're
going
to
But you aren't going towards Alabama. You're going towards.
When you go up 400 towards Dahlonega, you're going to turn left and head west towards Dahlonega. You keep going straight, and Helen will be a little bit northeast. So from downtown Atlanta, Helen's going to be closer to 2 hours.
Right.
Dahlonega and Ellijay about an hour and a half each.
And if you're not into Oktoberfest, like I'm not, that's really your thing. I like to fish. There is some amazing fishing up there in Helen, don't you think?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. So you can drop off whoever, you know, is important to you, pick them up later, but you can go fishing.
If you are into trout fishing, North Georgia, we have, we're not the best trout destination in the world, but we have a great Department of Natural Resources that does stock our lakes and streams in North Georgia. And a lot of these mountain streams can be found in and around the Helen area. So you'll find the headwaters of the Chattahoochee River.
They even have a yearly tournament.
Oh yeah.
Trout tournament.
It opens up the season every year. You can go to Helen and bring the family and have the kids fishing, and they have great prizes. Keep going. Where did I just lost myself?
Kind of like the Salmon Derby in Alaska.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
So Smith Gall Woods is a great place to explore. Unicoi State Park is a great place to explore. Duke's Creek is a wonderful, even if you're not fishing, you can just kind of go walk around and Duke's Creek. It's a great place, but they all have different regulations. So if you're going, make sure you check the local regulations for where you are. Places like Duke's Creek can require you to register in advance before you can fish there. So just make sure that you're following the rules. A lot of it is the limits are there, but if you get a big one, please catch and release it. We don't have a lot of big ones up in North Georgia. And we've got, so also in North Georgia, we've got the Georgia Mountain Fall Festival, which is going to take place in Blue Ridge. The dates here are going to be the 11th through 13th and the 17th through 19th. And this festival features country music performances, carnival rides, arts and crafts, fun contests like pumpkin decorating. And it's a great way to experience Georgia's rich history and culture. Lots of fall festivals happening. North Georgia is the place to be. And with the temperatures dropping, this is the time of year to go. So today...
Well, we do have four seasons in Georgia, North Georgia, at least. Well, it's pretty defined compared to other places. Some places skip over fall and spring immediately, but we do have actual seasons here.
Yeah, we do.
We don't have snow.
I define snow as a season coming from Massachusetts, but I was there until I was 11. I've been in Georgia most of my childhood and my entire adult life. So this is home. And part of home is getting to explore our local communities. And today we're going to do a spotlight. As we're talking about North Georgia, our spotlight is on Blue Ridge, Georgia today. So we're going to talk about all things Blue Ridge, what's there to explore, some of our favorite spots. And
there's some interesting real estate up there in Blue Ridge.
And there is. We can talk a little bit about the real estate side, the vacation rental market. So Blue Ridge is a little bit further north from Ellijay. It's about 20 minutes to the northeast.
It's got the best downtown I've ever seen.
It is so
I love it.
Cute.
I know. Easily walkable too.
One of the things that brings Georgia together is Blue Ridge together, makes it an absolute destination, is it is home to the Blue Ridge Scenic Railway. So we actually have Celine, you know about this. Have you been on it as a kid?
I've been on it once when I was very little. I was born and raised in Georgia, but I think this was when I was 3 or 4. My mom, I'm the only child, and she wanted to take me everywhere. So all of my cousins were older, so they were already doing these things. And I've got to say that Blue Ridge in the fall, because the leaves change colors and it's so pretty there, they actually sell out all the way. And even Christmas time. Did you know that? I actually looked into the Polar Express rides that they give at Blue Ridge on the Blue Ridge train expressway, I want to say. Yeah. And they sell out because they do Hot Cocoa and Santa. So it's actually just the start of the season for that destination. They have other specials too for holidays, but it's mainly, to me, the leaves changing colors and then the Christmas time for the little kids. And they have all these different family activities there too. It goes straight into downtown Blue Ridge, and it's kind of a centerpiece for everybody. Mm-hmm. You've got shops lining around both sides of the train tracks, and then you have the iconic Blue Ridge train that comes in. There are other stops that it makes too on the way.
Yes,
it's a round trip.
They run different schedules.
Yeah.
On the exploregeorgia.org website, talking about the Blue Ridge Scenic Railway, it says, step back in time as you and your family enjoy a 4-hour railway excursion along the beautiful Toccoa River from Blue Ridge to McKaysville. There are different options for your seating. You can either choose an authentic indoor car, an open rail car, or premier class. The destination is the mountain town of McKaysville, Georgia, which is a sister city to Cooper Hill, Tennessee. And during the 2-hour layover, you have lunch or walk across the blue line on the street and you're in Tennessee. You can stand in two states at once if you have one foot on the Georgia side and the other on the Tennessee side.
It is a little pricey though, and I would recommend doing the indoor covered one because it's a little windy on the ones that aren't.
It definitely can be, especially as we get cooler.
Yeah. I think that's one thing I do remember. I was really cold. I think my mom got an outside seat.
Well, if you're interested in the Blue Ridge Scenic Railway, you can go to brscenic.com/tickets to see all of their packages. And the holiday special rides you were mentioning, those are going to start November 29th and run through December 24th.
They fill up fast. So seriously, reserve it.
There you go. Also in Blue Ridge, so we probably when the kids were, 4 and 2, Claire wasn't born yet.
Yeah.
We got all of our friends together. Myself, Ryan, Brandon, we got all the families, all the kids, and we rented this big cabin for a weekend, for a Father's Day weekend 1 year. And we brought all the kids down to Mercier Orchards. They got to explore and shop.
You gotta tell them what Mercier Orchards is, though.
So Mercier Orchards is a landmark in Blue Ridge. They are an apple orchard, but they also do peaches, strawberries, cherries. They have over 50 varieties of apples, and the cider is so good. I remember the cider.
Their store is substantial and it has a bunch of souvenirs. It has, you know, those like country side stands where they have the canned goods, but it's not, they've got like a cottage license to make them, not like, you know, someone's just canning stuff. It actually has a label on it.
And jams, chow.
Yeah, that type of stuff. They do fresh fruits and vegetables as well.
Yep, pickled okra.
Yep.
They'll do all sorts of stuff like
of
that.
Of course, the breads, the bakery stuff. I think that they had
a great toy shop.
Yeah.
They had lots of old-timey toys.
The one place that you were attracted to, like a fly, was the bar that they have.
They do have a bar.
Yeah, and then was it a sampler bar or what?
I was
behind you, so I don't remember.
It's been 6 or 7 years since we've actually been to Mercier.
I think they have wine, too.
But they do sell alcoholic ciders there.
Right.
So you can check it out.
And they were decent, too, right?
Oh, they were so good.
Yeah. So get some, take some home to your parents, you know, and say, hey, here's a gift from our trip.
Exactly. Speaking of alcohol, Blue Ridge is full of wineries or vineyards and breweries.
Yeah.
So while you're in Blue Ridge, if you're interested in agritourism, you could check out Sarenberry Vineyards. Along with Bear Claw Vineyards. They both offer great settings where you can hang out, taste wines, or if beer is more of your style, you could check out Angry Hops Brewing and Grumpy Old Men Brewing. Both are located in downtown on East Main Street.
You almost knocked that cup down.
Well, there's still coffee in it. I'd like it back. Take my caffeine away. So the
husband management
always. Blue Ridge is a very quaint mountain town, and they have some amazing stores, some great locally owned places to check out, from the breweries to the orchards. But it's part of North Georgia, and what makes it great is not being inside all the time. So going up there, there's amazing waterfall hikes, mountain biking, trails to explore, whether you wanted to go chasing waterfalls at Falls Branch Falls or Long Creek Falls, which can be seen on about a 30-minute hike. There's plenty of map guides out there. We can post a link where you can find some of those in the show notes. There's also Lake Blue Ridge, which was formed by a hydroelectric dam, and the Lake Blue Ridge Marina, where you can either rent a boat and go out for the weekend, or paddle boards, paddle boats. They've got a lot of things that you can rent there. Or you can check out some tubing, kayaking, and rafting. So Lake Blue Ridge Outfitters and Rolling Thunder River Company can set you up with kayaks, or you can you hire them as a guide and run one of their river trips. We've talked trout fishing for Helen. Mm-hmm. Did you know Blue Ridge has some of the best trout fishing in the state of Georgia? The Toccoa River is one of the best spots. So it's very popular for trout fishing. You can arrange trips through either guides or outfitters. You can check out Appalachian Anglers, the Cohutta Fishing Company, Fly Fish Blue Ridge.
Cohutta has a storefront in downtown, right?
I'm
pretty sure they do.
Yes. They used to have one also in Cartersville, but that location's no longer there. Okay. I have a Cohutta Fishing Company hat that's older than my son at home right now. Noontula Creek Farms is great, North Georgia trout fishing. One of the things that you just got to be aware of is depending upon where the guides are taking you. Sometimes there's private water in Georgia, sometimes there's public water. Private water, a lot of those fishing trips are catch and release. But Blackhawk is around the Helen area, and that fly fishing charter company can take you out onto the Soquie, which is predominantly private water. But I could easily get sidetracked talking about fishing all day, and that's not the point of this show.
A lot of people actually have vacation homes there.
Yeah.
Blue Ridge and Helen.
It's a great vacation rental location because so much happens year round. Did you know that you can go zip lining or horseback riding in Blue Ridge?
Can't you do that in Helen too?
Yeah, actually you can.
Yeah.
But I didn't know that Blue Ridge had a place. They have the Blue Ridge Adventure Park, which has, it's an aerial obstacle course, and there's various difficulty levels. They also have a zipline canopy tour, which has 13 zips and a 75-foot high platform. I don't think I'd ever get you onto something like that.
I'm acrophobic.
Yeah.
No.
It was, we did.
I'll just look at it from the ground.
we'll have to talk, when we talk about Atlanta and Centennial Olympic Park, we'll have to tell the story of getting you up in the air.
Oh, God.
There's lots of places to stay in downtown Blue Ridge or the surrounding area. You can check out the Hampton Inn in Blue Ridge, which is located in the heart of downtown. They also have a Comfort Inn and Suites.
Or VRBO. Airbnb. There's
lots
of them.
That's cabins are huge. So you can either go through Airbnb, VRBO, or you can check out some of the local management companies like Escape to Blue Ridge, who has luxurious hotel style amenities for a lot of different cabins, or Southern Comfort Cabin Rentals. They're all within 15 miles of downtown Blue Ridge and have friendly and responsive staffs. We've got Mountaintop Cabin Rentals, Blue Cabin Rentals, Cuddle Up Cabin Rentals, and Georgia Mountain Cabin Rentals are other options. So find a place to stay. I feel most at home getting out of the beaten path. So when I go up to North Georgia, I like to be off-road, no pavement. That's just, it helps me disconnect.
Camping?
No, just get into a cabin.
Oh,
I've done camping.
I know you have.
We do that a lot less nowadays with the
older
kids. And yeah, it's easier just to rent a place and get out.
We're not poor college kids anymore.
Yeah, that was
that
a lot
was,
to do with
rough.
It too. There's tons of great dining while you're here, and this is one of the best things about
you
Blue
took
Ridge.
Me to that really good restaurant, Blue Ridge.
Black Sheep.
Oh my God, that was good.
That was so good. The Black Sheep is
it's
probably
like
my
casual,
favorite.
Right?
Whenever you're
okay
in
there.
A mountain town, fancy is not what fancy is in Atlanta. Right?
Okay, well,
so
it's good.
You don't have to do a suit and tie, but you dress nicely, right? You're not going to show up and rip jeans to a place like this, but the Black Sheep restaurant and bar.
No, you wouldn't.
It's full service. It's Southern fare with fusion. So some of their favorites include Asian tuna nachos, elk chops, fresh pasta. They do have an outdoor patio for seating. This is the perfect time of year to do it. It's a great date night. We went there for a date night a few years ago, had a wonderful time. The cocktails are superb. There's also Harvest on Main, which is nationally recognized. It incorporates some of the best local ingredients. They are a farm to table. They proudly list all their vendors in the dishes, like Georgia caught shrimp, Logan Turnpike grits, pan roasted Springer Mountain chicken, and Bramlett Farms trout barbecue. So lots of great stuff to enjoy there.
Some of those names are
familiar. Yeah.
Yeah.
They're all local. How do you pronounce this? Is that
Cucina?
Cucina? Rustica?
Yes.
This is an old world. And it's covering many regions of the country of Italy. So it includes wood-fired pizza, seafood, pasta. And if you go on weekends, you can check out the veal ossobuco, which is generally a limited availability dish. I've had ossobuco before. It's delicious. You have Masseria Kitchen and Bar. That's a huge pizza hotspot. You've got the Tekoa Riverside Restaurant, which is great for a glass of wine or beer on the river's edge. They sell things like fresh local trout, steaks, seafood, pasta. They even have a menu for pets, so pets are welcome.
So speaking of restaurants in Blue Ridge.
Yeah.
Do you remember that cafe that was owned by that French lady? You know what went up in flames?
Oh, yes.
That entire thing just burned. All of it. I don't remember what the name was, but she was there for a long time.
That was at Danielle's Cafe.
Danielle's Cafe.
Yeah.
And the whole thing just burned.
That actually caught fire last year.
Yeah.
And the business was a total loss.
Good food.
It was amazing food, and it was right next to the little ice cream shop.
Mm-hmm.
One of our favorite things to do in downtown Blue Ridge is just to walk around with the kids, checking out the stores, and getting ice cream at some locally owned.
They like the businesses. General store. It's one of those. Oh, yeah. You know, the. It looks like Cracker Barrel almost, and they have tubs of candy that you can just grab and then put into a weighted bag. You know, you weigh it at the end, and then however many pounds is how much you pay. Just tubs of it. There's even a giant boat in the middle with candy filling it. They love that place so much.
And one of the great things, so some of our favorite stores, there's lots of outfitters. Mm-hmm. The general store down there is fantastic. You can get the old-timey toys and candies. You know,
stuff that you haven't seen in a long time.
You know, you want to get the kids playing outside. It's a great place to go and pick up a bug net and exploring kit. We've had plenty of those through our house as the kids have learned to explore those. Blue Ridge Olive Oil is always a great spot.
Yes, they're balsamic vinegars.
So good. Blue Ridge always has something going on.
Yeah.
So whether it's the Arts in the Park, which happens every spring and fall, where more than 100 local artists and vendors come together, the Blue Ridge Trout and Outdoor Adventures Festival, which brings a food truck alley and a beer garden. The Blues and Barbecue Music Festival happens in September every year, which just finished. So Blue Ridge has a lot to offer, and we hope that you get out and explore and get to check out one of our favorite little fall destinations for spending time with the family. It's good to get out of the house.
Yeah.
The nice thing about Georgia, and I truly have loved this since moving here, is there's so much to do within an hour to 2 hours of the city. You can be on a lake in Acworth, or in, you know, you can be on Lanier, you can be in the mountains, you can be in Tennessee, South Carolina, North Carolina. There's just so much that you can do within a 2 hour radius here. So please go out and check it out. All right, switching gears. We want to talk a little bit of real estate, and with fall coming into full swing. I want to give some staging tips. So if you're thinking about selling this fall, we want to talk about, one, what we're seeing happening in the market, and two, some tips to make your house stand out. So Celine, you run Simply List, which is an advertising service where homeowners can sell their homes for sale by owner, like an agent, because they can get onto the MLS system, or they can opt to have some assistance with contract review. So they can do the marketing themselves.
You do more of the full service.
I do the full service side, yes. Mm-hmm. But because of your business model, you tend to have a lot of listings. And with that comes data. And you get to see what's actually happening, what's selling, what's not. So I'm curious, would you tell us a little bit about what you're seeing today, mm-hmm. and what's helping people move homes?
Yep. So the majority of people, regardless of whether it's now or before, don't stage homes. It's costly. Yes, there is a factor in that. And a lot of the times, there aren't good stagers out there as well. There are actually two different types of staging. There's real, actual furniture, staging in person, and then there is staging digitally, which is very different. And
virtual, yeah.
Yeah, virtual staging, and technology has really increased a lot. So still, a lot of people aren't staging, but for those who are, they're choosing either real or the virtual. And as far as buyers, whenever they go into homes and it's virtually staged, I don't really hear much complaint about it. Like, oh, it's not there. Because they can easily take out their smartphones and then look and see what the picture showed. And hey, you can put the table here, you can put the chair. However, I do think that it does make a little bit of a difference to have it in person, because when you're physically at a place, your spatial recognition, kicks in. So I really think that they're both very different modes and they both work differently, right? You've got a cost perspective and then you've got humans aren't creative. So, advertising perspective to that too. I'd say it's 50-50.
I think that when it comes to effectively making a buyer fall in love with the house, and that's really what we're trying to do, mm-hmm. is give the buyer the chance to fall in love and make and envision themselves living there. It's hard to do that when you're looking at an image. You don't have all of the senses coming together. Seeing it, having, as you said, that spatial recognition is huge. Virtual staging, I think, comes into play really well when you have an unusual space and in a vacant house.
And you know what? I prefer it sometimes because you can pick the style of furniture mm-hmm. a lot better.
Yeah.
I want to say a real stager will have a set amount of furniture. And because they can't buy the entire catalog of Wayfair or anything, right? They're usually going to go for a little bit more higher quality mm-hmm. furniture, solid wood, that type of stuff. Not IKEA, press board, whatever they use. I'm not so sure. MDF, I think.
All furniture is, you have different levels of quality.
Well, it's usually a higher quality when you do it in person. However, you're kind of limited to what is in stock there. Virtually, if you have a modern house, and I'm talking about the ones that are coming up recently that I've been seeing, the ones where it looks like building blocks that are put on top of each other.
Oh yeah, very square style. Yeah, that's a modern construction. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, we had the farmhouse phase, which is still going on, but now you have a lot of the modern stuff. And then, so what kind of furniture goes in that? Is it your traditional Chippendale furniture, or is it going to be a little bit more modern, which can cost a little bit more as well because they're unique pieces? So I like, if I were using it, I think it depends on the property.
So what do you, as far as staging goes, first off, the way staging works, digitally, it's easy. We take the photo of a vacant house. We send it to our editing company. Our editing company sends us back a version with photos.
And they're very staged. Fast at it.
They're very fast and it's high quality.
Yes.
There are lots of companies to choose from. We use one called Box Brownie, which is out of Australia because their quality is top notch. They're more expensive on the editing, but again, top notch. It's not just limited to AI. The shadowing is realistic. And we usually put both photos online. We'll have a vacant photo and the staged photo so that the consumer doesn't feel bait and switched when they get there. We want them to know, hey, this is a virtually staged photo. It's done so that you can see how the furniture is going to fit into the room. Now, staging, where we have a home stager that comes out to the property, brings the furniture, that usually runs on a contract. Celine, do you want to explain how that works?
Well, it depends on their business model. They're all different. They're usually independent businesses and they're privately owned normally. And you go for a certain amount of time. So say 3 months contract, 6 months contract, and then you have to pay according to how much time you're using that furniture. So I see commonly 3 months, 6 months. I don't know if it's gotten longer with this market because the houses are sitting longer on them. What is the average number of days in Atlanta now?
We were hovering around 45, I believe.
45. Okay, so we is 45 days.
We covered that last week, if you want to go back and check out the last episode.
So if it's 45 days, then 3 months at a time would make sense, right?
Yeah, and so they're going to come, they bring the furniture. Sometimes those contracts can be as little as 6 weeks.
It depends on the property.
Just like with the virtual staging, you don't have to have the house staged for the entire duration of while it's listed. Sometimes you'll have people who will stage the property for the first 3 weeks, first 6 weeks, and then after that, the stagers will come and remove everything, and then the property sold as a vacant house. You follow the trajectory, and there's a cost-benefit analysis. Usually the staging is going to pay off up front, but only if the other areas of the house make sense to a buyer. Because a buyer is not going to come in and say, ooh, I'm going to buy this house because I like that table. They're going to come in and buy the house because it works for them. The layout works, the quality and condition of the house is up to their standards, and the price and location meet their needs. So if you have the best staging in the world, but you're overpriced, your house still won't sell, especially in this market. So all of the variables have to line up for it to make sense. But a stager, well utilized in the right application, can be used to increase buyer demand. For example, if we had a house that was competitively priced, meaning maybe slightly under what the house is worth, with an idea to generate business by bringing lots of interest to it. And we have the house professionally staged and it's to the nines. And we compile all that with a great campaign and an open house, a weekend open house where we're doing double Saturday and Sunday. We can bring out 30 to 40 people in the right application. And then having all of that go together along with the demand can really help sell a property. But it has to be done right. There's a lot of things that go into it, including all of the variables. And it's not an easy thing to get, but sometimes it can happen.
We don't do it on every one of our listings either. There is definite cost and, you know, analysis that goes into it, whether you should use it or not.
Absolutely. So if you're not at the point, if you're going to sell your house and you're not at the point where you are out, so the house isn't vacant, you have all your stuff there. There are still some things that you can do to make your house stand out and have it kind of semi-staged, right? Celine, what are some of those things that sellers can do to using their own furniture and what they have today to make their house show better?
Well, you've got the major areas, the kitchen, master bedroom, living room, right? Any other major ones? Bathroom?
Your primary bedroom, your primary bath, mm-hmm. Your curb appeal as you're coming in, your kitchen, dining, living areas.
Everyone has a certain amount of time, right, during the day. So yes, you can go all out, but if you are on a limited time schedule and you can only do, or, you know, you want to do it yourself and you only want to do a few rooms, focus on those highly sought after rooms. Those ones that make or break the deal, like, oh, this kitchen it's just too narrow or something like that, right? I hear that a lot.
Yeah.
Or there's no space for a island or some other things like in the bedroom. There's a sink right here, like a random sink, you know, things like that.
Yeah.
You can't fix that, but there are certain things that you can do to make it look a little bit more appealing. I don't know how much appealing you can get with carpet in the bathroom, though, you know?
Well,
don't do that.
It's a personal preference.
Don't do it.
Most people hate that preference. So if you like carpet in the bathroom, you're not going to get any complaints from me. But I will tell you that most buyers are going to need a concession to have that changed.
Yeah.
So here, there's a couple of things. I think you hit the nail on the head, honey, when you said there's not enough space. A lot of buyers come in and look at homes and say, there's not enough space here. And most of the time that happens because we get in a position just as homeowners, people, we follow goldfish syndrome, right? We grow to the size of our constraints. So if we have a closet and there's room for stuff in that closet, guess what? We're going to fill that closet. And we might not feel it immediately when we move into the house, but by the time we're ready to move and we've outgrown this house, we're bursting at the seams.
I think that's why we're seeing so many storage facilities come up.
Totally agree.
There's so much stuff.
And one of the
get rid of it.
One of the best investments you can make as a seller is in a temporary storage unit while you get your crap out of the house. Make the house look livable with its current size. I think that's one of the biggest things. When you open up a closet, your items should look organized. It should, you know, have your towels stacked. Don't shove the extra 5 towels and compress them all down to fit between the 2 shelves. Take 5 towels away and just have 2 or 3 there and make it look livable. Decluttering is the name of the game when it comes to selling your house. When somebody walks into that property, they want to envision themselves living there. And if they see your stuff stacked from floor to ceiling, cluttered, all sorts of small appliances on the counter, they're immediately going to think, there's not enough room in this house for me to live here comfortably.
There is one exception, though, that I want to make.
What's that?
And that is if you are actively moving out or if you have something staged for sale, that it depends on the price point. If you have stuff in the garage, it's obviously there for a reason. You could, if you don't want to get a storage unit to take all the stuff there, you can put it in your garage. It's understandable.
You can, as long as it's neat, it's boxed, and you create, you're not using the full garage, right? People need to be able to explore that area of the house if they're going to buy it. So having one area where it's stacked, even if it's floor to ceiling, but you can walk around it on all sides, you can access or see the exterior wall, you can see the windows, that kind of stuff. So yes, we have successfully sold homes that are mid-move, sellers are packing, but that's what they did, and they kept the rest of the house very well staged, very clean, very decluttered. Now, along the lines of decluttering is personal items. Celine, what do you tell your sellers when they have lots of family photos or religious or personal effects that they have everywhere in the house?
I love them. Love them somewhere else. Take them down. It's human psychology. If you go to somebody's house and there are pictures of your family up, it's your home, and they naturally don't want to intrude on that. And that's not the point that you want to make when you're trying to sell your home, period.
Yeah. If you have guests over and you're showing them your photos from your ski trip or little Timmy's graduation, those are perfectly acceptable.
They're just better suited elsewhere right now.
But when you're trying to sell it, you want the buyers to envision themselves in your house,
yep,
thinking it as theirs. And the only way, one of the ways that you can do that is to remove the signs of you so that they're free to think about that. It's one of the best and most successful tips that we've had. You know, and people are, I get questions a lot, Chris, how much stuff can I leave out? Or, you know, we've got all of these photos, I don't have room to put them all away. Look, if you've got one area of your house with a bookshelf and you have a bunch of family photos on that one shelf,
sure,
that's fine. It's not throughout the whole house. If you've got family photos on every wall in every room, and it's on the bedrooms, and it's in the primary, and it's in the bathroom, and it's in the living room, that's too much.
There is one thing that I want to point out, though. If you have niche tastes or like niche hobbies,
yeah.
Say you are absolutely into rabbits, I don't know, the animal, right? And then you have rabbit statues everywhere, rabbit prints and
rabbit drapery, rabbit comforters,
or whatever
rabbit
else.
Rabbit toilet seat covers.
Yeah, that's a little weird. That needs to go.
Your taste isn't bad.
No.
But when it comes to sales, we market to what the consumer wants, not to what we want. This is why we use so much data as a team. We study data. That's all Celine and I do. Because when a buyer is coming to a house, we want that house to match up to the most buyers that are going to be interested in that house. So there's nothing wrong with anybody having unique tastes and being eclectic or having yard art or any of those things. But we market homes to the broadest market possible, the broadest number of buyers possible. So if you're meeting with an agent and an agent tells you, you don't want to have this, you need to redo this decor, we need to stage your house, there's probably a reason for that. And it's not to be a personal attack and say that your taste is not going to be appreciated by other people. It's just not going to be appreciated by the most number of people. And when we want to sell a house, especially in this market, we need to make the house fit for the most number of people. So that's, I think those are some of the biggest things, you know, as far as personal effects. This also goes for religious effects. Not to say that anybody, one is right or one is wrong. It's just that you want people to feel at home. And if you have somebody coming through that's a different religion and you have religious effects in every room of your house and you have plaques that say religious things in every room of your house, I mean, those are the things you got to get rid of.
All right. One more thing, though.
Yeah.
Just thought of this. It's election season.
Get those political posters off your yard if your house is for sale.
I mean, I'm all for voting, but this world is weird.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just stay away from it.
The rule. Politics, religion, what's the other one? Health. You just generally don't talk those three things because your politics, religion, and sex. Right? You don't bring those three things up in conversation. You don't bring those things up in marketing. If your religion is visible, if your politics are visible, just get rid of it. Because immediately, hiding it does no wrong. But if you're showing it, you're going to alienate at least 50% of potential buyers right off the bat. And I don't know about you, but I can't afford to eliminate 50% of my business. So I believe that's it for today's episode of Georgia Living.
Already?
Wow. Yeah. We're just at about an hour. We've covered our topics. We would encourage you all to check us out at selectrealty.com. Follow us on YouTube, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, anywhere you get your podcasts, or for our Select Realty agents. We love having you tune in live as we record this here in the Select Realty studios in Marietta, Georgia. If you've got an event coming up and you want to give a plug on the show, please let us know. You can email us at contact@selectrealty.com, 2 L's in select. And as we get a little bit better at this, we'll be making improvements.
I've actually got one that's coming up.
You have a
yeah
an event coming up?
No, like this was so I just got notified it, but there is a red, white, and blue barbecue this Saturday, and the date, just to be clear, is on
Saturday,
October,
I believe, is the
12th,
2024,
and it is a barbecue, like one of those barbecue cook-offs in Canton. Ooh. And so my Daughters of the American Revolution chapter is going to take our dog tag American flag for veterans. We've been making this huge dog tag, like red dog tag, white dog tag, blue dog tag in the shape of a flag.
Cool.
With veterans, U.S. veterans, and each color represents whether they're alive, deceased, currently in uniform.
Oh.
And so I've written my, you know, grandparents' names on there, my dad's name. They're all going to be there with extra tags so that participants can fill out their own veterans and put it on. With a little zip tie. And when that is done, that is going to be in the Georgia room at Spicer Library in Marietta.
Oh, cool.
On permanent display. So yeah, get your relatives' names on there and have it as a permanent display in the library, and have some barbecue while you're at it.
Fantastic.
I don't have a time for it, but it is the red, white, and blue barbecue.
All right. We'll see if we can find some information and post that along with the show notes on selectrealty.com. So you can get all the information from today's show and stay up to date with us. If there's anything that we can do to assist you in the community, please don't hesitate to reach out. We are here and selling homes left and right. So very excited to see what this fall is going to bring. But I am super stoked for all of these festivals coming up. I've lost about 10 pounds over the last month from not eating junk food.
And you did eat my apple pie.
I did eat half of the apple, almost half. I didn't eat half. I feel like there were five of us in the house and I got two pieces out of a 6-piece pie. So
that's a lot.
I'm a happy guy. Not at one sitting.
Okay.
Close to it, but well, I'm looking forward to getting maybe some fried pies or some more cider.
Oh.
Thanks so much for tuning in. This is Georgia Living Podcast. We'll see you next week.
Bye.